Did you know that you can simulate evolution in your computer? And that by doing that, you can solve really, really hard or otherwise unsolvable problems? That's what we are going to do today. If you're new here, this channel is about programming. If you want to get new knowledge every Monday, subscribe now and hit the notification bell. So, here's the problem. Let's say you want to go on a trip. And all you can bring with you is 3 kilograms of hand luggage. So you want to make the best out of it. You can choose between a laptop, headphones, a coffee mug, a notepad and a water bottle. You weigh every item and attach a value tag to it. Now it is just a matter of finding the right combination of items to bring with you to max out the 3 kilograms to get the most value into your backpack. If you want, you can pause the video now to figure it out. Very well. The correct solution is laptop, headphones, coffee mug, water bottle for a total value of 740 and a weight of 2.9 kilograms. That was not so hard, right? Our brain is really good at finding a good solution or with a small number of items, finding the best solution relatively quick. For a computer, this is easy as well. Even with the naive implementation of just trying out every possible combination, we just have 32 different combinations when it comes to these 5 items. And my MacBook can do this in 3 microseconds. So let's add some more items, shall we? What do you think is the correct solution now? Pause the video again if you like. This time the correct solution is phone, baseball cap, laptop, headphones, coffee mug. I'm not sure I would have the patience to figure that out in my head. And my MacBook also needed 807 microseconds, which is a whopping 269 times longer to find the solutions out of 124 combinations. With 20 items it took 1 second already. And the number of combinations rose to 1,048,576 combinations. With 21 items, it took 1.94 seconds and 22, 3.91 seconds and so on. You get the idea. Here's the graph. At some number of items, you won't only miss your flight, but the whole solar system would be gone. To be precise, only 77 items are enough to occupy my MacBook for 5 billion years before it comes up with the correct solution. You might think that there is a better and more intelligent way to calculate this than what I did. And I assure you there is. But one thing won't change. The time to get a correct solution rises exponentially with the number of items we have. So just to round things off here, the problem that we've just found is well known by the name knapsack problem, which has been studied for more than a century. And humanity doesn't know if there is an algorithm that runs quick enough to first decide if there is a combination of items to reach a certain value without exceeding the weight limit, nor to decide if a found solution is in fact the optimal solution. This question is one of the biggest open questions in computer science. It is called the P versus NP problem. And if you want to know more about it, I will link resources in the description below. But what does it all have to do with evolution in my computer, I hear you say? Have I been clickbaited again? No, because today we will explore one class of algorithms called genetic algorithms. Genetic algorithms can be used to generate solutions for problems for which we have no way to calculate a solution. And that is what we need right now. Genetic algorithms are part of a bigger group of algorithms called evolutionary algorithms. And they use natural selection to approximate solutions for a given problem. For instance, you can use it to generate the pack list for your backpack. But another way is to use it to generate the form of an antenna, as done by NASA in 2006. And this is called an evolved antenna, which a genetic algorithm generated to find the best radiation pattern. It looks a bit funky, but who am I to argue with evolution? So let's see how it works. A genetic algorithm uses a population of possible solutions. In our case, that would be combinations of items in our backpack. Each specimen in our population has a genome that encodes the solution. It is a binary encoding of the content in our backpack. A 1 says that this item of the item list is inside the backpack, and when there is a 0, it is left out. The set of all current solutions at a given point during the algorithm is called the generation. Generation 0, the starting generation, is just a random mess of possible solutions. So we start our evolutionary process with complete chaos. Now it's time to start the process of natural selection to simulate the survival of the fittest. We use a fitness function to determine how good a given solution is. In our case, the fitness function returns the value of the packed items as long as it fits into the weight limit. If the weight limit is exceeded, the fitness of the specimen is zero. After that, we are selecting the parents for the next generation of solutions. Generally speaking, a solution with a higher fitness score is more likely selected for reproduction than one with a very low fitness score. Like in real life, the buff dudes get the girls. We choose two parents and cut their genome at a random spot in half and switch the endings. This is called the single point crossover function, and it generates two new solutions for the next generation. We repeat the process as long as we don't have enough specimens in the next generation. Did you notice how by crossing two solutions we got a better one? I find it really incredible to see that natural selection not only works in nature, but even simulated in the computer, it generates better solutions from generation to generation. But there's one thing to note here. Because the selection and the crossover function is governed by randomness, there is no way to guarantee that we won't destroy our best solutions. That's where a process called elitism comes in. Elitism simply means we select n top solutions and just copy them into the next generation. We will just keep our top two. The next step in evolution is the introduction of mutation. Mutation helps to discover new solutions that weren't otherwise possible with the gene pool we started with. During the mutation phase, we simply change a random bit of the genome with a certain probability. That's it. Here's our new generation of solutions. This algorithm loops as long as no satisfying solution has been found, or for a maximum number of generations. Now you understand genetic algorithms from a high bird's eye perspective. And despite the fact that there are different ways of implementing genetic algorithms, they all share the list of following ingredients. A genetic representation of a solution. A function to generate new solutions. A fitness function to evaluate solutions. A select function to select the solutions to generate the next generation. A crossover function, and a mutation function. Each of these ingredients can be totally different from what we use today. Some problems have solutions that can't be expressed with a string of ones and zero, but need an array of integer or floating point values. Some genetic algorithms even use graphs to express their solutions. Sometimes a single point crossover is not enough and you want to crossover multiple times, and maybe even with different parents, which interestingly has shown to increase the quality of generated solutions. There is a lot more to learn, and we are just scratching the surface. But I hear you say, is it really worth it? Let's see. I wrote a function that generates things called t1 till tn. T1 has the value and the weight of 1. T2 has the value and the weight of 2. I think you got the idea. Let's say we have the weight limit of 3 kilograms again. And I generate 10 things, so the maximum weight and value of all these things is 10 plus 9 plus 8 and so on, 55. Which means the best combination is just to pick all items and put them in the bag. This is a good thing. Normally, as I said before, it is impossible for us to know if a generated solution by a genetic algorithm is in fact the best and optimal solution. But in this case, we just know it. We can now calculate the value for the best solution and check how long our genetic algorithm takes to find it. And that's what I did. For each test of the genetic algorithm, we print the number of items it got to choose from, the time it took to find the best solution or to process 100 generations, the number of generations it took and how good the solution is compared to the optimal one, where 100% means it is spot on. For the first couple of items, it just got the best solution in the random seed. Which totally makes sense if the number of combinations is below 10 and the initial generation has 10 random solutions in it. The probability that the best solution is in there is really good. For 20 items, it just took 0.015 seconds to find the best solution. Compared to almost 1 second for the brute force approach, that is more than 60 times faster. And the calculation time is not changing with the number of items. Finding the best solution for 21 items was even quicker. That's because the calculation time is growing with the number of generations. And I didn't stop here. I also tried to calculate the best solution for 77 items. What would normally take over 5 billion years only took 0.18 seconds, and the solution is, with 95.27% accuracy, good enough for me. Actually, none of these runs with 100 generations has an accuracy less than 90%, which is, in my opinion, astonishing. Of course, this algorithm is not deterministic, and every time I start it, I get a slightly different result. But with more generations and even more generated solutions per generation or multiple runs, I will get a higher probability to find the best or the good enough solution. Genetic algorithms are fascinating, and there are quite interesting fields of applications for them as well. They are really good at approximating solutions for hard combinatorial problems, like scheduling problems or timetable problems. But they are also used to really simulate evolution. But with everything great, there are also limitations. The most obvious limitations when it comes to genetic algorithms is the runtime of the fitness function. If you need a long time to evaluate the fitness of a solution, it takes really long to generate solutions for the next generation. And therefore, generating a good solution will take a lot longer. If you want to create your own genetic algorithm right now, there might be a video of me explaining how to do it in Python. At least that is my plan for next week. If there is not, make sure to subscribe now and hit the notification bell so you won't miss it. And while you are already here, check out one of my other videos. And I will see you in the next one.